This morning I wanted to briefly talk with you regarding the cross. As you heard in the Synaxarium, today is kind of a prelude to tomorrow. We start celebrating the Feast of the Cross tomorrow, and we celebrate the cross for three days. And as you all know, we celebrate the cross twice a year, and this is certainly the first. There is no other gesture, no other sign that we make more frequently than the cross. So to some extent, what I'm going to share with you this morning is something that you already know. Some time ago, I remember coming across a preacher, a Protestant preacher, who just couldn't understand why is it that we venerate the cross. And he made a very logical argument. He said that if he had a friend that he loved, a friend that he truly loved, and that friend was shot, that he would not go around with a gun around his neck. He said that if his friend was stabbed, it doesn't make any sense for him to go around with a knife on his neck or tattooed on his arm. He simply could not understand what is this fascination with the cross. For him, it was a method of execution. It's a method of murder, of killing. What he fails to understand is that when we look at the cross, we do not see a limp, dead body up on the cross. When we look at the cross, we see an empty cross. We see a cross of the resurrection. And this has been obscured in the modern period. But it was very clear in the early church. In the early church, when you look at what the early church venerated, how they decorated their churches, there is a very odd phenomena. For almost 700 years, for almost seven centuries, there are no crucifixes. All of early Christianity, the crosses are always bare, the crosses are naked, the crosses are the crosses of the resurrection. Today, not only are crucifixes are common, which is fine, but we also have, because of our infatuation with Renaissance art, this idea that of the naked Jesus. Every church you go into, you have the naked Jesus. Historically, again, when you look at the early church, not only are there no crucifixes in the very early church, but once they started depicting the body of Christ on the cross, it is fully clothed. To them, it was embarrassing. How can you depict the Lord of glory naked on a cross? When we look at a cross, we see the empty cross. We see the cross of the resurrection, both of Christ and of us, the resurrection of the Christ through which we participate. Not a sign of death, but a sign of immortality and victory. We have to remember the words of St. Paul, which summarize the cross for us. And he said it, I imagine, almost in an absolute ecstasy. Death has been swallowed up by victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? It's no accident that the cross goes way, way back with Christianity. The very earliest evidence for Christianity, physical evidence, is a cross. The meaning of the cross to us and to outside is quite different. The cross for us is Trinitarian, and this morning I wanted to discuss with you what the cross means to the believer. And to the unbeliever, it is foolishness, and to the devil, it is a source of fear. But when we look at the cross, when we make the sign of the cross reminds us of a reality. It brings forth a reality. And there's a very important designation here. It's a little technical, but just going to take a second. Our society fundamentally confuses between symbol, sign, and reality. that is not the case within the church. When you think of the flag brings forth emotions of bravery, it brings forth emotions of our love for our country, but a flag is a symbol. A flag of the United States is not the United States. It's a piece of cloth that is colored that we give meaning to. As important a symbol as it is, as much as it ties us to our country, the flag is a piece of cloth. It is not what it stands for. In the early church, they are very clear that when they speak about the sacraments, when they speak about making the cross, it is a symbol in that the same power of the thing being symbolized is brought forth. What does that mean? When we make the sign of the cross, and we all know that the demons fear it, it's not that the demon sees the sign of the cross and says, oh, I remember that 2,000 years ago I was defeated by God, and hence now I will be scared. Rather, the demon sees the cross and he sees the power of God. It is there. It is real. The power of the resurrection is there. It's not some memory. It's an actual fact. When we make the sign of the cross, it is sacramental. It brings forth the power of God. It is not just simply a symbol for God. It brings forth the power of God. When we make the sign of the cross in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, we are remembered, we are reminded, and we bring forth the love of the Father. And the Gregorian liturgy beautifully lays it out for us. He who created us out of nothing, brought us into existence. He who gave us authority over creation. He who, when we were lost, sent us the prophets and eventually sent his Son to the cross on our behalf. When we make the sign of the cross, we are reminded and we make real the grace and the sacrifice of the Son. We are reminded that, as we are saying the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that Son came willingly to the cross, that he was obedient even to the torturous, disgraceful death on a cross, which he transformed into his glorious resurrection. We are reminded each time that we make the cross that we were bought at a price, that we are indeed dear to God. We are not one person out of billions, but we are a name that is inscribed since the beginning of time. St. Paul, in his epistle to the Galatians, beautifully inscribed this over and over again. At one point, he tells them the verse we're all familiar with, "May I never boast. May I never take pride, may I never languish in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." And again, same epistle tells them that I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives through me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. When we make the sign of the cross, we are reminded of the unity with the Holy Spirit. Through the water, through the baptism, we gain adoption. Again, St. Paul to the Romans is very clear. You receive the spirit of adoption, through whom you can address God as Abba, as Father. Without the Holy Spirit, no one can address God as Father. It is the Holy Spirit who unites us, who brings us to the love of the Father and to the sacrifice of the Son and the resurrection of the Son. And again, what we mentioned earlier regarding symbol and sign. When we speak about baptism and the role of the Holy Spirit in baptism, baptism is not a sign, a dead symbol of a reality. It really is a burial and a resurrection with Christ, mystically, divinely with him. It is the Holy Spirit who allows us to partake of the bread and life and to be one with Christ and as one body. It is he who allows us to partake a divine nature. When we make the sign of the cross, we are reminded of our purpose, of our true purpose, our true calling as children of God, reminding us how dear we are to God, how precious we are, in that we were purchased at a price, and the price is the blood of his Son. It reminds us that we must be crucified to the world, as St. Paul has said, and that we are new creatures. We are new creatures, not really free to an extent. We are free to do God's will, but we are not free in an absolute sense. When we make the sign of the cross, we are also reminded of our small crosses, of the crosses that we all bear, the troubles, the tribulations, the temptations that we all bear. And bearing the cross in that context, our small crosses sometimes seems monumental. Sometimes it's the hardest thing you can do. Our images for the carrying of the cross kind of go through a very wide spectrum. On one hand, you have kind of the monks and the ascetics. On the other, just as a visual image, the first thing that comes to your mind is probably the procession. We got a big cross at the beginning, somebody is carrying it, and we are at the tip of a procession holding the cross proudly. But you know that truly carrying the cross, there is no procession. It is hard. And for that, we have to think of the cross in several ways. Carrying the cross sometimes is really leaning on the cross. Put it down, put it under your arm, use it as a crutch. If you can't carry it, drag it. Crosses are great. It's a great sign, great symbol that Christ chose. You drop a cross on the ground, you tilt it just a little, and it turns into a plow. Remember the parable of the sower? The different grounds? How do you go from bad ground to good ground? Well, you till it. You get a plow and you till it. And if you can't carry the cross, then drag it. Turn it into a plow. The sign of the cross is Trinitarian. It brings forth the power of God, not in memory. We do not commemorate something that happened 2,000 years ago. We are commemorating, we are remembering a daily reality, a daily power that is with us. In fear, the sign of the cross comforts us, because it reminds us of the Father who loved us, the Son who died for us, and the Spirit who adopted us. In sickness, it strengthens us, because again, it reminds us of the Father who loved us, the Son who died for us, and the Spirit who adopted us. In loneliness, it fills our world, because it reminds us that even if it doesn't seem so, that we are not alone. That again, we are bound by the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Even at that decisive moment, the moment of death, on that deathbed, we gain strength from the cross, reminding us of the sacrifice that was laid for us, of the Father again who loved us, the Son who died for us, and the Holy Spirit who adopted us. Even at that terrible moment, we are glorified because we partake in his resurrection. We become one with him. and even at that most decisive moment. Even at that decisive moment, let us praise with Paul, almost mockingly at death, and saying to him, "Death, where is your victory? And Hades, where is your sting?" Glory be to God forever. Amen.